Okay, good evening everybody and welcome to this webinar, and I'd like to thank Pranjali and Burren Trust for inviting me to give this talk this evening. It's a very strange kind of environment to be giving a talk, but it's a lovely day and I hope all of you have had a nice day in the present circumstances. So what I'm going to be talking about tonight is work that I carried out in two caves that are located in the Burren, Glencurran Cave and Moneen Cave. Both of those caves were used at lots of different times in the past, but in particular they were very important places in the Bronze Age, and that's what we're going to look at tonight. So sorry, I'm just having a little technical difficulty here. Okay, so thank you for bearing with me. Okay, so we're going to start off after that glitch, and I'm going to talk a little bit about caves in Ireland generally, and then I'm going to focus in on Glencurran Cave and then Moneen Cave, and then bring it together and talk a little bit about what they tell us about Bronze Age activities in the Burren. So just to set the scene a little bit, we have almost 1,000 caves in Ireland between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland. If we want to be quite specific, it's more about 980 caves. And you should be able to see on your screen there a map of Ireland and the clusters of caves in the Republic of Ireland. The light grey colour that you see is the limestone spread in Ireland. So here we only have caves occurring in limestone bedrock. And of course, the Burren is primarily limestone, the upper Burren. So that's why we have such a concentration of caves. You can see where Moneen Cave and Glencurran Cave are there, and that dense concentration of caves in the Burren. Out of all of those kind of 1,000 caves in Ireland, about 100 of those are of archaeological importance. And when we talk about that, we mean that over the space of, you know, about 10,000 years, we have activities we have human activities in about 100 of those sites. Clare has the largest concentration of caves in the country. About 260 caves are located in the county, and that's 38% of all caves in the Republic of Ireland. So just to focus in on prehistory and how caves were used very generally between the early Mesolithic, so from about 8000 BC right up until the end of the Iron Age at 400 AD. We see that caves have a very restricted usage. They're very much associated with death, with burial, and with ritual activities. And there are three main forms of activity. So if you look at the first image there, Kilgrainy Cave in County Waterford, at this site we have evidence of burial. So this is where people were bringing their dead into caves, placing them on the floor of the cave, and then leaving offerings like pottery, maybe a stone axe, scrapers, different artifacts or burial grave goods with the dead. In the second image there, you see a cave on Knocknarea Mountain in Sligo that was used for a practice known as excarnation. And this is particularly common in the Neolithic, in the Stone Age, where the dead are brought into a cave, they're laid out on the floor, and then after the flesh is decomposed, maybe 6 months or 12 months later, the community come back and they collect the bones from the cave and put them at another location, such as in a megalithic tomb. And typically at these excarnation sites, what we find are small quantities of the smaller skeletal elements. So things like finger bones, toe bones, maybe vertebrae, so bones that would have been missed during the main collection. We excavated this site, myself and Dr. Thorsten Kallert from Queen's University a couple of years ago, and this is how we had to access the site head first. And then the third image that you see there is Killoura Cave in County Limerick, and this represents another way that caves were used in prehistoric Ireland, where offerings of human bones and artifacts were placed at cave entrances or inside caves. We don't really know what these offerings represent, but presumably they're offerings to the ancestors or offerings to the gods, or maybe the cave is perceived as a sacred place and the offerings are placed there for that purpose. What's really striking, if we look at this really long period, roughly 8,500 years in Irish prehistory, is that none of the caves are used for settlement. We don't find people living in caves. We don't find workshops in caves. They're not using caves for everyday activities. They're not storing material in caves. Those kind of activities take place in historic times, but not in prehistory. And what that tells me is that caves are very much associated with ritual, with the dead, with the other world, with the supernatural. And in prehistory, in Irish prehistory, they don't seem to be suitable places for everyday activities. They're too sacred. So we're going to look at the Bronze Age in particular, and specifically the Middle and Late Bronze Age. So we're looking at a period from between 1400 BC to 600 BC. So basically 3,500 years ago to about 2,500 years ago. And it's in this particular part of the Bronze Age, the Middle and Late Bronze Age, that we find evidence that people are traveling very deep inside caves. Up until that point, during the Mesolithic and the Neolithic, which are the Stone Ages, people were using the outer parts of caves. They were carrying out their burial and ritual activities around the entrance areas or just inside the entrance. But they seem to have been afraid or very reluctant to go deep inside caves. That changes from about 1400 BC. And we see that people are traveling deep inside caves, and they're specifically looking for the darkest and deepest parts of these caves. And they're the parts of caves that become the center of attention for burial or for ritual. We find caves are being used for votive deposition, these dark areas of caves. What we mean by votive deposition is when you leave an offering, a votive offering, in a cave. So it's, you know, a gift that, again, you're leaving for the gods or for the dead or for the ancestors or for the place itself. There's also a suggestion that some of these caves are used at this time for ritual retreat. So it's a form of Bronze Age cocooning. And this is where people or shamans and the spiritual leaders of the time, I think, are going into certain caves and spending periods of time there, maybe a few days or a few weeks. We don't know exactly why they're doing that, but presumably it's to enact some kind of ritual practice, or to ask for requests, or to commune with the spirit world or the afterlife. So we're going to look firstly now at Glencurran Cave, which is located in the heart of the Burren. And this first came to my attention about 2002. Cavers had found a human jawbone, a human mandible, in the cave in the 80s. And I heard about this from Colin Bunce around 2002, and he took me to the cave. You can see where the cave is located. For those of you who know the Burren, we've got Carron village here in the north, and we've got Kilnavoy in the south, and Glencurran Cave is located in the centre, just on the edge of the Burren National Park. When I went there in 2002 with Colin, we were looking at the deepest part of the cave in archaeological terms, and I came across this beautiful, beautiful object. It's a wolf tooth, a wolf canine, and it's been perforated. So somebody has put a hole in it, and it would have been worn as a necklace. We don't know the exact date of it, but it's looking to be about 3,000 years old to 3,500 years old. And that was sitting on the floor of the cave during that visit in 2002. And there were a lot of other bones on the floor of the cave that you could just walk over, human bones and animal bones. So we got in contact with the National Monuments Service, and they funded a rescue excavation. And that developed into a research excavation funded by the Royal Irish Academy. Altogether, we spent 12 weeks working in the cave between 2004 and 2009. Now, that's actually a very short period of time in archaeological excavation terms, but it yielded a huge amount of archaeological material. We recovered about 34,000 animal bones, 135 human bones, and almost 500 artifacts. So it's an incredibly rich site. And this little artifact, this wolf tooth, is still my favorite archaeological find ever. We always get that asked that as archaeologists. You can see here a picture of Glencurran cave, and where the man is standing at the back of the cave, this is where all of those objects that you see in front of you were discovered. And all of these date to the Middle Bronze Age and the Late Bronze Age. So what we have is an individual or individuals going into the deepest part of the cave. That was about 60 meters from the cave entrance. They're walking through this very, very dark passage. We have charcoal from the excavation, so they probably had wooden torches lighting up their way. And when they get to the back of the cave where it's completely dark, they're placing all of these objects on the ground. Some of these are little bone beads. You can see two lovely bone beads here, a little stone bead. This is our wolf pendant, our wolf tooth pendant. We also have a number of seashells. These are broken scallop shells, but we also have dog whelk shells. And these are sherds of late Bronze Age pottery. So we have about four different vessels, four pottery vessels from the sherds when they're put together. One of the most significant discoveries at this time are these lovely amber beads. We have two collections of amber beads from Glencurran Cave. Nowadays, amber is relatively cheap and it's easy to access, but in the Bronze Age, this was a very prestigious material. It was basically equivalent to gold. There was no native sources of amber in Ireland and very little in Britain. It's usually understood to come from the Baltic region, from this part of Europe. One of our former students, Lisa Maloney, carried out ATR, FTIR analysis of the amber beads from Glencurran Cave, and she confirmed that the beads from Glencurran Cave came from the Baltic about 3,000 years ago. So this is really important, because what the amber beads are telling us is that we're getting objects of great wealth, objects of great value being placed in the cave, as well as the seashells and the bone beads and the stone beads. This is what the floor of the cave looked like when we were excavating it. It's basically like a carpet of bones. You can see some of the larger bones here, but we had lots of smaller bones on the surface. Lots and lots and lots of bone. And it seems that in the Bronze Age, people are bringing animals or joints of meat and human bones into the cave and placing them on the cave floor. They're not covering them over, they're not concealing them in any way, they're exposing them on the cave floor. One of the most interesting things is that we have the deposition of several newborn piglets. We have three or four newborn piglets that are brought into the cave and placed on the floor. We have several newborn lambs and several newborn calves. These are very, very interesting, and many people have asked me, would these have been sacrificed? And it's quite possible. They may have been natural fatalities, but the fact that we're getting such a concentration of them being brought into the cave, it looks like they're being sacrificed. They're all newborns, so they wouldn't have had any meat. We're not looking at feasting or the remains of meals. We're looking at complete newborn animals that are being brought into the cave and placed there in the Bronze Age. What you can see over here on the right are human clavicles. This is the shoulder bone, and it's a really unusual phenomenon, but we have people in the Bronze Age collecting these human clavicles, these human collarbones, from graves or tombs outside the cave and bringing them in and placing them on the floor of the cave with the newborn domesticates. We really have no parallel for this. I don't know any other site in Ireland or UK or anywhere in Europe where we have clavicles, this particular bone, being selected and being brought into the cave. So clearly for Bronze Age people, that particular bone has some kind of significance. It has some meaning. Another thing that's interesting is that none of these bones were burnt or cremated. Whereas when we look at the Late Bronze Age generally in Ireland, the vast majority of burials are cremated. It's quite unusual, quite rare to find unburnt human bone. So again, this marks out Glencurran Cave and the activities there as being different in some way. None of these particular bones relate to burial. We know that they were brought in what we call a disarticulated state. They were brought in a little bag or a basket and placed in the cave. But we do have one burial from the cave. It was very disturbed when we found it during the excavation. You can see the black area here is where the burial was placed. And this black area is rushes, a bed of rushes that were cut and brought into the cave and laid down as bedding. And on top of those rushes, we have a 2 to 3 year old child. You can see the skull of the child and some of the bones, but it was very, very disturbed by later human and animal activities at the cave. And that burial was dated to 1400 BC, so a child who died 3,500 years ago. It was different to the little animals because this child was 2 to 3 years old. It wasn't a newborn. So certainly there's no suggestion that this was a sacrifice. It may be a child who died of natural causes and for some reason was brought into the cave and was placed with these other offerings. You may be able to see these little white dots on the image, and these little white dots are shells. Cowrie shells and flat periwinkle shells, and each one of those shells was very, very carefully perforated. So they made little holes in each of those shells during the Bronze Age. And presumably this was a necklace or a piece of jewelry or some kind of leather bag or clothing. And these little shells were sewn onto it or strung together to form a piece of jewellery. Again, it's a very, very unusual discovery for the Bronze Age in Ireland. There's no parallel. Altogether, there were about 70 to 80 of these little shells with this child. So it indicates a burial of some significance. It's a very unusual grave cut to find. There's some suggestion that while these objects and materials were being brought into Glencurran Cave, that somebody was also spending periods of time within the cave, maybe days or perhaps even weeks in the deepest and darkest part of the cave. And the reason that we think that is because several of the objects that we found in this part of the cave show signs of working. So here we have an animal bone and it's been whittled away. Somebody has had a knife or a flint blade, and they've been carving it and sharpening or cutting part of the bone. We have a little dog whelk shell up here, and you may be able to see that it's got a very flat surface. It was being rubbed against a stone to try and create a perforation like this shell here, but it was never completed. So it looks like somebody was in the cave trying to convert this shell into a little bead and just never completed it. We also have chert and some flint from this part of the cave that was worked. So somebody is trying to create stone tools in the dark at the back of the cave. This is the kind of material that you might expect to find on a settlement site where you have people carrying out everyday work activities. But if somebody was living in Glencurran Cave, then surely this kind of work would have taken place near the entrance where there was lots of daylight and you could work in that area. But instead, these are at the very back of the cave. And I think that what they're suggesting to me is that somebody is staying in the cave. They're using the cave as a ritual retreat and they're spending days or weeks at a time in the darkness. Another piece of evidence that tells us that individuals are spending long periods of time in the cave is that we have this very unusual feature constructed about 20 meters into the cave. So if we look at the plan of the cave up here, this is the cave entrance, and you come through the entrance and then there's a very steep slope, a very narrow and steep slope down into the cave. And at the very end of that slope, we have this semicircular cairn, which is what you see down here. Those areas hashered are the areas that we excavated. There's lots of the cave that has not been excavated. So In the Bronze Age, we have people constructing this very, very unusual, in fact, it's a completely unique feature in the cave. It's semicircular, it's stone-walled, and they've collected the stones from other parts of the cave. And if you can imagine, it's completely hollow. It's like a horseshoe constructed against the cave wall. And the interior was hollow. And then they filled up the interior with all of this beautiful white calcite that they dug up from the back of the cave. So we can still find the holes, the extraction pits at the back of the cave where they dug up this white calcite clay material, and they brought it up to this part of the cave and placed it within this semicircular setting of stones. We have a few finds that were placed in between the layers of this white clay. We have a beautiful bronze ring, very similar to bronze rings that have been found in late Bronze Age hoards in other parts of Ireland. We also have some animal bone, and they've all returned late Bronze Age dates. Indeed, they're at the very end of the late Bronze Age. What you see here, it's not a great photograph, but you can possibly see finger rills. And this is where Bronze Age people scraped off calcite from the cave walls. And you see the hollows left by their fingers still visible on the cave walls. And they use some of this calcite to fill up the interior of this structure. We don't really know what the structure represents, but the radiocarbon dates tell us that it was built at the very end of the Bronze Age, a couple of decades or maybe a century after the last deposits were placed at the back of the cave here. So it may be something like a closing deposit, a closing ritual to mark the end of the use of the cave, because after that, it seems to have been abandoned for at least 1,000 years. So we can say at the moment that Glencurran Cave was a sacred space for about 800 years. It was used for the burial of a 2 to 4 year old child, and it was also used for votive deposition, where objects of wealth and human bones and animals were brought in and placed as offerings on the floor of the cave. The amber beads tell us that it was a high status community, or a community who had access to prestigious materials who were using the cave. It may also have been a place for ritual retreat, so that somebody, maybe a ritual practitioner or a shaman, was living in the cave for a period of time. And the clavicles raise the possibility that we have rituals related to osteomancy going on. And this is basically something that we see in a lot of traditional cultures, where particular bones of the human body or bones from animals have these certain properties or associations, and it's a magic that's used with particular bones. So the cave may have been used for some form of magic with these particular bones. Of course, we have no understanding of that now, it's long lost, but they certainly had a particular significance. So just to jump forward then to Moneen Cave, it's about 9 kilometres from Glencurran Cave. It's just outside Ballyvaughan village, and you can see it on the side of Moneen Mountain. The entrance is circled there just beside a boundary wall on Moneen Mountain. And again, cavers are responsible for discovering the archaeological material in this site and for bringing it to the attention of the archaeological authorities. They discovered some of the Bronze Age pottery in the cave in 2011, and that led to a 2-week rescue excavation, which I directed with a team of archaeologists and cavers in August 2011. And this rescue excavation was funded by the National Monuments Service. So to get to Moneen Cave, you have to climb up the mountain. And this is the entrance to the cave. It's a very, very small entrance. The entrance is in the roof of the cave. So you basically jump down through the opening here in the roof, and this is the chamber underneath that opening. It's an incredibly small cave, very different to Glencurran Cave. It's a very, very small space, but it was used at about the same time. It was used in the Middle Bronze Age and also in the Late Bronze Age for similar purposes. this is what the interior looks like, a very small chamber that's dominated by this massive boulder that's standing upright in the center of the chamber. And this boulder seems to have been the focus of attention. So what we have with Moneen Cave is that Bronze Age people were dropping down through the opening in the cave roof, and they were placing objects around this boulder or possibly on top of this boulder. One of the most interesting finds was this early Bronze Age antler hammerhead or mace head. And here you've got two views of the same object. So this object was made from an antler, from a stag antler, and it's this part of the antler, the burr, which would have attached to the stag's skull. Here you can see two stags at war with one another. So this object was made from antler, and you can see it's been perforated. So they cut off the little tines and they drilled a hole through the center. And then you presumably had a wooden handle through this perforation. We don't know whether it's a hammerhead or a mace head. A hammerhead suggests a hammer, so an object that would have been used like a modern hammer. A mace head would suggest something ceremonial. And the reason that we can't decide whether it's a hammer or a mace head is because these objects are incredibly rare. This one was radiocarbon dated. We took a very small sample of antler from inside the perforation, and it returned a date in the early Bronze Age, so roughly about 2000 BC. So we're looking at an object that's 4,000 years old. We've only got five other examples of antler mace heads in Ireland, and none of these have been radiocarbon dated. They all come from Neolithic or Bronze Age contexts, and several of them come from lakes or near the sea. So we have one from Limerick, we have one from Lake Inchiquin in Clare, which is not too far away. We've one on the coast of White Park Bay in Antrim, another one near Lochgar Lake in Limerick, and another one from the Boyne River in Meath. The fact that all of these are turning up near rivers or lakes would suggest that there is some kind of ceremonial or ritual function. We don't find these kind of objects on Bronze Age settlements, and this would encourage me to think that the example from Moneen Cave was also a ceremonial object. Apart from the antler hammerhead or the antler mace head, we also have a series of objects and bones and joints of meat being placed in Moneen Cave at different stages in the early Bronze Age, Middle Bronze Age, and Late Bronze Age. So for example, up here we have a pig pelvis. We don't know if this represents a joint of meat or perhaps an entire pig, but it was placed in the cave about 2000 BC, so roughly 4,000 years ago. We also have a second piece of antler. It's very, very weathered, which suggests that it was exposed outside the cave for a period of time. That was brought into the cave in the Middle Bronze Age. One of the interesting things from Moneen was a collection of oyster shells, and these date to the Late Bronze Age, so roughly 1000 BC. So these obviously were collected from the beach, possibly outside Ballyvaughan, and they were brought up to the cave and placed again, potentially as offerings. We also have a number of butchered animal bones, like this butchered cattle rib. You might be able to see the very, very faint butchery marks on part of this rib. And this would suggest, again, joints of meat. Now, taken together, we might think, well, maybe this is domestic refuse. It might represent someone who lived in the cave. But the fact that we've such a long tradition of unusual things being placed in the cave, it's more likely that they represent some kind of ritual offerings. We also have 350 sherds of Late Bronze Age pottery turning up in this cave. And the pottery has been dated by Elaine Lynch and Helen Roach to about 1000 BC. And all of these sherds make up six different vessels. And Elaine has created this illustration of what those vessels would have looked like. They're typical Middle and Late Bronze Age vessels, bucket shaped and tub shaped. They're not very impressive. They're not very pretty compared to some of the earlier pottery that we get in Ireland, but there's a substantial concentration of them in the cave. What we know is that these vessels did not come into the cave intact. We find sherds of pottery were brought into the cave, and there are two reasons for that. These sherds are like making a jigsaw. So what a pottery specialist will do is identify the sherds that relate to a particular pot and then try and rebuild the pot. And none of these sherds made anything more than 40% of any of those six pots. The second important thing is that we have sherds from one of the vessels, vessel six, and these sherds, some of the sherds from the upper part of the pot were very, very weathered, and they had been exposed to the weather outside the cave, and then other sherds from the same pot were very, very well preserved. So this indicates that this particular pot, and probably all of the pots, had been broken outside the cave and then exposed for a period of time. Sherds were collected and brought into the cave. That might seem like a very unusual thing to modern eyes, but it's something that we see throughout European prehistory, that objects are deliberately broken and then brought to special places and placed there as offerings. They're not always intact. This is a lovely illustration by J.D. O'Donoghue of how he imagines the chamber may have been used at Moneen Cave. So you've got the opening in the cave roof, one or two people dropping down into this small chamber and placing offerings on this massive boulder that dominates the center of the space. So Robert Chappell kindly created this image showing the spread of radiocarbon dates at Moneen Cave from the antler hammerhead, pelvis, from the pig, the chunk of antler, the pottery, the oyster shells, and the cattle rib. And it's showing a span from roughly 2000 BC to 1000 BC of things being brought to this mountain chamber and placed in the cave. If we look at the Late Bronze Age more widely in Ireland and look at the types of rituals that were going on, one of the main factors is that these were very, very public events. So for example, we have lots of stone circles in Cork and Kerry and in Ulster, and these were very, very public spaces, often associated with the solstices, and where we would imagine large numbers of people congregating and where everything was visible, everything was on show. One of the most common practices that we get in the Late Bronze Age is people gathering at rivers and at lakes and at bogs and depositing objects of great wealth, so objects of gold, jewellery, bronze weaponry, into these rivers and lakes and bogs. And these are offerings to the gods or to the other world or to the ancestors. We don't know why they're doing this, but it's a very, very common ritual in the Late Bronze Age, not just in Ireland, but right across Northwest Europe. And again, these would have been very public affairs witnessed by dozens and perhaps even hundreds of people. But what we're seeing at these two Burren caves, at Glencurran Cave and Moneen Cave, is the opposite to what's happening in the rest of Late Bronze Age ritual activities. So where normally rituals are group experiences, at these caves, it's likely that we're having individual experiences, so that you only have maybe one or two people going into these caves and carrying out ritual activities. It's something that's not being witnessed or not involving large numbers of people. So you're going from the public ceremony outside the cave at these stone circles and these wet places in the landscape to very private ceremonies inside in caves. So you've got this juxtaposition between visibility, rituals at rivers and lakes that are very, very visible to the community, and then these rituals in caves, which are very invisible. It's the opposite. With the rituals that are taking place in bogs and rivers and caves, there's a knowledge that's shared between everybody. But with the caves, it seems to be more about secret knowledge, that it's just these special ritual practitioners or shamans who are entering the caves and carrying out secret rituals, and the rest of the community don't really know what's going on. And of course, then you've got the very basic juxtaposition of light versus dark. So the other rituals are probably taking place in daylight, Whereas in caves, it doesn't matter whether it's day or night, it's always going to be pretty much in the dark. And then if we look at what's going on in the Burren in the Middle and Late Bronze Age, this is very interesting because the Burren, of course, is incredibly rich in terms of Neolithic and Early Bronze Age activity. We have lots of Neolithic and Early Bronze Age monuments and megalithic tombs like wedge tombs and, of course, Paul na Brón portal tomb. But we have very few Middle Bronze Age sites or Late Bronze Age sites. You could literally count them on one hand. So we have some habitation sites at Tisca, an enclosure at Carron, and hut sites on Turlock Hill that tell us that people were living in the Burren during the Middle and Late Bronze Age. We also have these Late Bronze Age communities reusing older Stone Age monuments and burial sites like Paul na Brón portal tomb and Paul na Uach burial cairn. But generally, we have very little evidence of Middle and Late Bronze Age people on the Burren. And a lot of archaeologists feel that we probably have a population decline at this time. So we've got a population decline, we have very little settlement activity, but yet we have these two caves being used relatively intensively. And of course, the questions that we need to ask then are, well, why were people placing offerings in these dark spaces during the Late Bronze Age? And probably one of the main answers to that is that it's at this time that we see a soil deterioration in the Burren. So when we look at an image like this of the Burren nowadays, that bare karst landscape, this bare karst landscape started to become exposed around the middle, from the Middle Bronze Age onwards. And all of the good agricultural soil started to disappear. And as one geologist said to me, it's literally disappearing into the caves. So we also know that across Europe, there are famines at this time. We know that there's a climatic downturn. So it's generally a time where communities are facing problems. It's more difficult for agriculture, more difficult for farming. And it may be that these things are forcing people into these caves, these special places, and they're placing all of these objects of wealth, whether it's their newborn farm animals or these beautiful amber beads, and they're placing offerings and maybe asking the gods or asking the ancestors for a change in circumstance and perhaps hoping for a better outcome. So I think that is pretty much my 40 minutes bang on. Thank you very much for listening. It's such a pity I can't see any of you. It's such a strange environment, but Pranjali will take any questions and I'd love to answer any questions you may have.
Hi, I'm trying to unmute myself there. That was fascinating, Marion. Do you want to? Oh yeah, you stopped your screen there. That's perfect. Yeah. That was wonderful. Thank you so much for that. I might see the first question here seems to be, hi, Marion, is there any specific evidence for shamanistic ritual?
Yeah, it's very difficult because that kind of activity is pretty much invisible. You know, what we have are we've got these unusual objects turning up, especially in Glencurran Cave, at the back of Glencurran Cave, but it's very difficult to interpret. Personally, I think a lot of it is related to some kind of shamanic rituals going on there, but that's the joy of prehistory. You never know for sure. It's, you know, it's interpretation, it's best estimated guesswork, but we can't say for sure because, of course, these people didn't leave any written records. So we're looking at the physical remains and trying to understand them.
Hi, Marion. Fascinating talk. Thanks a million. I have a question here from Robert McGuire. He just wants to know in general, he admits that he might not know, but is there any known examples of cave paintings or even rude engravings on cave walls in Ireland? Why is this compared to cave sites in France, for instance?
Yeah, so I guess when we think about cave paintings, we generally think about the Paleolithic paintings that we get in France and in Spain, and we have none of those in Ireland. We don't have any carvings or paintings in Irish caves at all until, you know, the post-medieval period, maybe from the 17th century AD onwards. that doesn't mean that people weren't painting or carving in Irish caves, but they haven't been found or they've been eroded because, you know, Ireland is very, very wet. Limestone is a very soft rock. So let's say somebody painted on cave walls 4,000 years ago, almost certainly it wouldn't survive in a lot of the Irish caves at present, unless you're using particular techniques to find it, but it wouldn't be visible to the naked eye.
Excellent, thanks.
Anna May says, this is fascinating. It's rural internet here in Donegal for her, so not allowing her to stay, but she'd be grateful for to know if the piglet bones would be some way domesticated animals or wild. Could they be wild by any chance? And she has a second question, sorry, Marion. She would also like to know if archaeologists make confident links with spiritual cave views elsewhere in time and place based on evidence here.
Yeah. So in terms of the piglets, they could be wild, but it's more likely that they're domesticated, especially when they're found with calves and with lambs, almost certainly pigs. You know, these little piglets were also domesticated. In terms of, I mean, I suppose one of the important things when we look at prehistoric cave use or any type of prehistoric activity is to look at how caves are used in other cultures in you know, the modern day or in recent times. So for example, we know that the Mayan people have, you know, a lot of spiritual traditions around cave use. Aboriginal people have a lot of spiritual beliefs around caves. So certainly, I mean, it's a very universal phenomenon, the idea of caves being access points to the other world, to the underworld, to the spirit world. And we find throughout the world, through all periods of time, that a lot of caves take on this kind of special ritual significance, that they're very sacred places. They're like the cathedrals of modern centuries.
Great. John Sweeney has asked, what is the story of the boy's skull who was found in Moneen Cave? Can you elaborate?
Yeah, so the boy's skull from Moneen Cave, that's a 17th century boy who died, a 12 to 14 year old boy who died a few hundred years ago. And so that's been fully published, John. You can check out Marion Dowd Academia and you'll get lots of publications there. And that, as well as all the Moneen material, is now in the National Museum in Dublin. So if anybody wants to access any of that material, you write to the National Museum and it's in careful storage there.
Hi, Marion. Gareth Jones has asked, how does the discovery of Alice in Gwen and Gwendolyn's cave relate to these two caves?
Hi, Gareth. It's a bit of a trick question. So we'll be publishing about Alice and Gwendolyn later this year. Obviously, the material from Alice and Gwendolyn is significantly earlier than the material from Glencurran Cave and Moneen Cave. I don't think we have anything Bronze Age from Alice and Gwendolyn. It's earlier. So there isn't any direct correlation.
So this is a good question because I think there's a few other questions that relate to it. Are these places open to the public, Marion? These caves?
Yeah, I should stress that no, these are caves on private property. And we, as archaeologists, had to ensure that the landowners were happy for us to excavate there. We always worked there with their permission. But these caves are not open to the public. They're on private property.
Marion, superb presentation, says Brendan. Do pollen records from the region tally with what you say about the loss of soil and reduction in farming activity?
Yeah, there's some very interesting work done by Daisy Spencer. She published it just late last year, some of the pollen work that she's done near Lake Inchiquin. And that's actually kind of showing a different picture to some of the earlier pollen studies. And what seems to be the case is that it depends on the area of the Burren, so that we're getting different signatures. In many cases, the pollen is telling us that there's, you know, decrease in woodland and an increase in agricultural activities in the Middle Bronze Age and Late Bronze Age. And that doesn't match with the archaeological record, with what physically survives above ground or whatever. So yeah, I think that's still an area that has to be explored a little bit more. But I think from the work that Daisy and others have been doing, we're seeing that there's different signatures in different parts of the Burren, different levels of activity.
So here's a question from Mary Quinlan. What may have the karst landscape looked like at the time of, the Bronze Age?
In the early Bronze Age, you would have had woodland, grassland, arable, pastoral, farming land. And then from what I understand from the Middle Bronze Age onwards, you're starting to get more exposed limestone. So what we associate with the Burren today, that would have started to kind of register from the Middle Bronze Age onwards.
Ian Graham has asked, wonderful presentation. Do you have any lean learnings from Ailwi to share? Ailwi caves.
From Ailwi, yeah. I mean, Ailwi is a lovely example of, a cave where you can revisit older material and get new information. So Ailwi has never been archaeologically excavated, but there was a collection of animal bones from Ailwi Cave that have been there since the 70s. And we carried out a project a couple of years ago. And, it was always believed that there was, the bear from Ailwi Cave, and the radiocarbon dating showed that there were actually two different bears. So there was, a Mesolithic bear and a Neolithic bear. So it just shows that, material that was found in caves 50 years ago, 100 years ago, has still lots of information to offer, especially because we've got so many new scientific techniques now that, we can apply to older artifacts and discoveries.
Hugh Carthy is wondering, was it in Glencurran that you discovered the Viking necklace?
Yeah, we have a lovely, I think it's possibly the largest Viking necklace in Ireland or Britain from Glencurran Cave. It's a real mystery as to why it should turn up at the back of the cave. It's been dated to about the 9th century AD, so about 1,100 years old. We know that somebody was living in the cave at that time. This would be in the early medieval period. It's possible, well, it's quite likely that the cave was, that the necklace was stolen and hidden in the cave, maybe by the person living in the cave or by somebody else, but it's really spectacular. And actually, Joanne O'Sullivan has carried out analysis of that necklace, and she thinks that there are actually two necklaces there. I mean, when we discovered it, it was 80 glass beads. The string material had long since deteriorated, and Joanne thinks that there are so many beads that there were probably two necklaces rather than one necklace.
Okay. Raymond Stallings has asked, thank you, that was very interesting. How big a population do you think did Burren support at this time?
Oh, that's a really, really impossible question to answer. I would just be picking a number out of a hat. It's very difficult for us to give any kind of population estimations for prehistoric periods, and particularly when we have so little archaeological material surviving for the Middle and Late Bronze Age, you would really be just picking a number out of a hat. So I'm sorry, but I can't answer that. I don't think anybody can.
Fair enough.
Margaret Murray wants to know, were there any bones of unexpected animals found, i.e. not farmed animals?
Yeah, we have lots of hare from Glencurran Cave. We have bear from Glencurran Cave. We have bear bones from Moneen Cave. At Moneen, it's a young bear, I think about 6 months old. So it's possible that a bear was using the cave for hibernation or something like that and died. So yeah, we have bear, hare, we have a cat bone as well from Glencurran Cave, which is quite unusual. We have a number of dogs, lots of bird bones as well. Of course, many of these are natural occurrences. We've got badger, fox, pretty much the whole range.
Good. Kim has asked, why do you think the pots are broken or were broken?
Yeah, this is such a common thing in archaeology where things are deliberately broken. And one of the interpretations is that it's symbolizing the death of the object, especially when they're found with human remains. So that in the same way that when the person dies and their body basically disintegrates and the bones break up, the skeleton breaks up, that this way of breaking objects is mirroring that transition, that you're going from being complete to being broken, and that it may be symbolic with death, something like that.
Elena Mali has asked, was there any evidence of human burial in either of the caves, Marion?
Yes, so at Glencurran Cave, we had that burial of the 2 to 3 year old child that's been dated to the Middle Bronze Age. At Moneen Cave, we have no evidence of Bronze Age burial. We have no human bone of Bronze Age date. I should stress that, you know, our excavations at both sites were relatively limited. There's lots of, you know, archaeological deposits there that haven't been excavated. So, you know, an archaeologist in 10 years, in 100 years might find more. But at the moment, we only have the 2 to 3 year old burial in Glencurran Cave, the 2 to 3 year old child.
Thanks. This Marcus Byrne has asked, hi Marion, thanks for your interesting presentation. Was the stone in Moneen Cave recumbent or was it a standing stone?
It's, hi Marcus, it looks like it's in the recumbent position, and we think we can figure out the scar in the cave roof that it collapsed from. So it's a massive boulder that fell off of the cave roof. It may have been positioned in place, or it may have just kind of naturally ended up in that position. I think it's more likely that it was kind of maneuvered into place, but it wasn't actually brought into the cave.
So Deborah McDermott has asked, I'm interested in the amber that was found. You said this connotates wealth, if I understood you correctly. Would you talk about what this says about migration patterns at the time?
Yeah. With the amber, we know for definite that it's come from the Baltic. What we don't know is whether that was one transaction, whether we have someone going from the Burren to the Baltic region and bringing back amber from Poland or vice versa, or whether that amber had a very disjointed journey. Maybe it went to the UK and then it went from the UK to Ireland. And we don't know, you know, how many trips were involved in those amber beads or pieces of jewellery coming to Ireland. So at the moment, you know, it's difficult to say. What we do know is that the Irish had this great desire for amber during the Bronze Age. It seems to be the ultimate thing that they're trying, the ultimate prestige material that they're importing from outside to a far greater extent than Britain, for example.
Mm-hmm. Joan McDougall has asked, any theories on why they chose clavicle bones in particular?
No idea, and it's such a strange thing. You know, I've done a lot of research, you know, on clavicles. From what I understand, they're one of the last bones in the body to fuse, but we really don't know. One suggestion that was put to me was that when in times of famine, when people are incredibly malnourished, these clavicle bones become very, very prominent. You know, that's just one suggestion. But again, I suppose when we're looking at prehistory, you really have no idea what things like that mean, and all you can do is guess. What we can say is that the people who were selecting them knew the human skeleton. They recognized these as clavicles, and they had some kind of particular meaning that they assigned to this particular bone.
So I suppose coming towards the end of it, but have you any more archaeological cave discoveries up your sleeve, Marion?
Sure you do. Well, we were excavating in Alice and Gwendolyn Cave, which is outside Ennis. It's not technically in the Burren. We were excavating there last summer. So this year it's about writing up that excavation. And of course, you know, in the current climate, we've had delays getting scientific analyses and whatnot completed. So that's the main cave project that I'm working on at the moment.
Thanks, Marion. I might take the last question now. We have very few minutes left. Do you plan more excavations on these two sites? What else might you be interested in looking for? Is there more stuff to be found in these two
sites? Personally, I'm not, I'm finished, you know, my work at these two sites is finished now. Moneen Cave has been fully published and there's a book available on the excavations. Glencurran Cave, it was such an enormous amount of material that it's taken quite a while to work into publication. There is some material online already published, but next year will be the year for the Glencurran book. No, I think a lot of archaeologists in cases where they're excavating for research purposes, we understand the need to leave some archaeology there for future generations to excavate when they have different techniques and, you know, better approaches or more scientific developments. So no, I think it's, we've got a huge amount of information and there's lots more left for the next generation of archaeologists.
Marion, where can people find your publications and the books you've written?
Yeah, so if you just Google Marion Dowd Academia or Marion Dowd, you know, caves, and you'll get my academia page, and there is a huge amount of published material available there for people to download for free.
Thank you, Marion. That was truly fascinating. So I hope our attendees are happy with the answers, and apologies to those whose questions we couldn't take today because of time. But thank you, Marion, for joining us. It's an unusual situation. You're talking to a computer, but we appreciate you doing it for us today. We learned a lot today. Just for our attendees to let them know, this is the final of our Wild Wednesday webinars, but we have a host of other online events planned for next week for Burren in Bloom. So I hope you'll join us. There's going to be talks and discussions, a family quiz on flowers, and an art workshop and storytelling. So please check it out at www.burrenandbloom.com and register for it. So the events are expected to begin at 7 p.m. on Wednesday next week. And our opening talk is by botanist from Trinity College Dublin, Jane Stout, who will talk on Ireland in bloom and a vision for nature and people, or vision for people and nature. So we're really looking forward to that, and this will be followed by a farming for nature discussion. So Bridget, you might talk a little bit about what that's going to be like.
Yeah, sure. We have two of our Farming for Nature ambassadors, Tommy Early and Kim McCall, will be joining us. So probably after Jane starts talk at 7 o'clock, they'll be joining us. And we have two short videos on them and their farm, and then we'll open it up to the crowd, to people to ask questions about their farms, about their farming practices, their methods, their conservation methods, what they've done on their farm for nature. So it's kind of an open Q&A for people to kind of understand how to incorporate biodiversity more on their farm. So we have Tommy Early and Kim McCall. So do join us next Wednesday. You have to register beforehand, and you do that on burrenandbloom.com. And so it's next Wednesday between 7 and 9, starting with Jane Stout, as Pranjali said, and then following on from that, it will be two of our Farming for Nature ambassadors. So we hope to see you at this and many more of the Burn and Bloom events next week. Thanks very much for joining us, and thanks very much, Marion, for a fascinating talk. Really, really amazing. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye, everyone.